This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Treaty of Waitangi Māori, Tiriti o Waitangi, is a treaty first signed on 6 February 1840 by representatives of the British Crown and various Māori chiefs from the North Island of New Zealand. It resulted in the declaration of British sovereignty over New Zealand by Lieutenant Governor William Hobson in May 1840. The treaty established a British Governor of New Zealand, recognised Māori ownership of their lands, forests and other properties, and gave the Māori the rights of British subjects. In return, the Māori people ceded New Zealand to Queen Victoria, giving her government the sole right to purchase land. The English and Maori versions of the treaty differed significantly, so there is no consensus as to exactly what was agreed from the British point of view. The treaty gave Britain sovereignty over New Zealand, and gave the governor the right to govern the country. Maori believed they ceded to the Crown a right of governance in return for protection, without giving up their authority to manage their own affairs. After the initial signing at Waitangi, copies of the treaty were taken around New Zealand, and over the following months many other chiefs signed. In total there are 9 copies of the Treaty of Waitangi, including the original signed on 6 February 1840. Around 530 to 540 Maori, at least 13 of them women, signed the Treaty of Waitangi in the 1970s. The treaty gained prominence amid greater awareness of Maori issues and grievances, particularly with regard to land claims. Maori have looked to the treaty for rights and remedies for land loss and unequal treatment by the state, with mixed success. From the late 1960s, Maori began drawing attention to breaches of the treaty, and subsequent histories have emphasized problems with its translation. In 1975, the Waitangi Tribunal was established as a permanent commission of inquiry tasked with researching breaches of the treaty by the British Crown or its agents, and suggesting means of redress. Almost 150 years after the signing of the treaty, the government tried to give judicial and moral effect to the document by defining another, new version, the spirit or intent of the treaty through specifying the principles of the treaty. The move showed that the original document was not a firm foundation for the construction of a state. Today the treaty is generally considered the founding document of New Zealand as a nation. Despite this, it is often the subject of heated debate, and much disagreement by both Maori and non-Maori New Zealanders. Many Maori feel that the Crown did not fulfill its obligations under the treaty, and have presented evidence of this before sittings of the Waitangi Tribunal. Some non-Maori New Zealanders have suggested that Maori may be abusing the treaty in order to claim special privileges. The Crown, in most cases, is not obliged to act on the recommendations of the tribunal, but nonetheless in many instances has accepted that it breached the treaty and its principles. Settlements for treaty breaches to date have consisted of hundreds of millions of dollars of reparations in cash and assets, as well as apologies. The date of the signing has been a national holiday, now called Waitangi Day, since 1974. Contents: 1. Background. 2. Drafting of the treaty. 3. Debate. 4. Signing. 5. Extant copies. 6. Meaning and interpretation. 61. Differences between English and Maori versions. 62. Difficulties in cross-cultural communication. 7. Effects. 8. Legal standing. 81. Sovereignty. 811. Waitangi Tribunals. Te Paparahi o Te Reiki Inquiry. 82. Binding on the Crown. 83. Legislation. 84. Principles of the Treaty. 841. Fourth Labour Government's Principles. 842. Principles. Deletion Bill. 9. Claims for Redress. 91. Public Opinion. 10. Commemoration. 11. See also. 12. References. 13. Further reading. 14. External links. Background. Main article: History of New Zealand. James Busby, British resident in New Zealand. He drafted a document known as the Declaration of Independence of New Zealand. The English navigator Captain James Cook claimed New Zealand for Britain at the Mercury Islands in September 1769, but the British government showed little interest in following up this claim for over half a century. Between 1795 and 1830, a steady flow of sealing and then whaling ships visited New Zealand, mainly stopping at the Bay of Islands for food supplies and recreation. Many of the ships came from Sydney. Missionaries, initially from Sydney and later from England, arrived in small numbers to try to convert Maori to Christianity, but were shocked by the frequent scenes of drunkenness and debauchery as single women and girls flooded onto the ships to service the sailors' needs in exchange for goods such as iron nails. Trade between Sydney and New Zealand increased as traders sought cowrie timber and flax, and missionaries purchased large areas of land in the Bay of Islands. The purchase of muskets by Ngāpuhi in Sydney began a devastation of the Maori population in a series of as many as 3,000 tribal battles known as the Musket Wars between 1807 and 1845. In 1831, 13 chiefly Rangatira from the far north of the country met at Karikari to compose a letter to King William IV asking for help to guard their lands specifically. The chiefs sought protection from the French, the tribe of Marion, and it is the first known plea for British intervention written by Maori in response. The British government sent James Busby in 1832 to be the British resident in New Zealand. In 1834, Busby drafted a document known as the Declaration of Independence of New Zealand, which he and 35 Northern Maori chiefs signed at Waitangi on 28 October 1835, establishing those chiefs as representatives of a proto-state under the title of the United Tribes of New Zealand. This document was not well received by the Colonial Office in Britain, and it was decided that a new policy for New Zealand was needed from May to July 1836. Royal Navy officer Captain William Hobson, under instruction from Sir Richard Bourke, visited New Zealand to investigate claims of lawlessness in its settlements. Hobson recommended in his report that British sovereignty be established over New Zealand, in small pockets similar to the Hudson's Bay Company in Canada. Hobson's report was forwarded to the Colonial Office from April to May 1837. The House of Lords held a select committee into the State of the Islands of New Zealand. The New Zealand Association, later the New Zealand Company, missionaries and Royal Navy all made submissions to the committee. The committee recommended a treaty be concluded with Maori. Historian Claudia Orange claims that the Colonial Office had initially planned a Maori New Zealand in which European settlers would be accommodated, but by 1839 had shifted to a settler New Zealand in which a place had to be kept for Maori. Due to pressure from the New Zealand Company, the Colonial Office was forced to accelerate its plans because of both the New Zealand Company's hurried dispatch of the Tory to New Zealand on 12 May 1839 to purchase land, and plans by French Captain Jean-François Langlois to establish a French colony in Akaroa on 15 June 1839. New letters patent were issued to expand the territory of New South Wales to include the entire territory of New Zealand, from latitude 34 degrees south to 47 degrees 10 south, and from longitude 166 degrees 5 east to 179 degrees east. Governor of New South Wales George Gipps was appointed governor over New Zealand. This was the first clear expression of British intent to annex New Zealand. Captain William Hobson. Hobson was called to the Colonial Office on the evening of 14 August 1839 and given instructions to take the constitutional steps needed to establish a British colony. He was appointed consul to New Zealand and was instructed to negotiate a voluntary transfer of sovereignty from the Maori to the British Crown, as the House of Lords Select Committee had recommended in 1837. Normanby gave Hobson three instructions: to seek a cession of sovereignty, to assume complete control over land matters, and to establish a form of civil government, but he did not provide a draft of the treaty. Hobson left London on 15 August 1839 and was sworn in as Lieutenant Governor in Sydney on 14 January, finally arriving in the Bay of Islands on 29 January 1840. Meanwhile, a second New Zealand Company ship, the Cuba, had arrived in Port Nicholson on 3 January with a survey party to prepare for settlement. The Aurora, the first ship carrying immigrants, arrived on 22 January. On 30 January 1840, Hobson attended the Christ Church at Kororika Russell, where he publicly read a number of proclamations. The first was the Letters Patent 1839, in relation to the extension of the boundaries of New South Wales to include the islands of New Zealand. The second was in relation to Hobson's own appointment as Lieutenant Governor of New Zealand. The third was in relation to land transactions, notably on the issue of preemption. Drafting of the treaty. Henry Williams, who translated the treaty into Maori with the help of his son Edward Marsh Williams, without a draft document prepared by lawyers or Colonial Office officials, Hobson was forced to write his own treaty with the help of his secretary, James Freeman, and British resident James Busby, neither of whom was a lawyer. Historian Paul Moon believes certain articles of the treaty resemble the Treaty of Utrecht 1713, the British Sherbo Agreement 1825, and the treaty between Britain and Sumbia Susu's 1826. The entire treaty was prepared in 4 days. Realizing that a treaty in English could not be understood, debated or agreed to by Maori, Hobson instructed missionary Henry Williams and his son Edward Marsh Williams, who was more proficient in Te Reo, to translate the document into Maori, and this was done overnight on 4 February. The translation of the treaty was reviewed by James Busby, and he proposed the substitution of the word Fukamininga for Waywinga, to describe the confederation or gathering of the chiefs. Debate on 5 February February, the original English version treaty and its translation into Maori were put before a gathering of northern chiefs inside a large marquee on the lawn in front of Busby's house at Waitangi. Hobson read the treaty aloud in English and Williams read his Maori version. Maori chiefs Rangadira then debated the treaty for 5 hours, much of which was recorded and translated by the Paihia missionary station printer, William Colenso Rua, a Catholic chief, who had been influenced by the French Catholic Bishop Pompilier, said, "The Maori people don't want a governor. We aren't European. It's true that we've sold some of our lands, but this country is still ours. We chiefs govern this land of our ancestors." Moka Kainga Mata argued that all land unjustly purchased by Europeans should be returned. Y asked, "Yesterday I was cursed by a white man. Is that the way things are going to be?" Protestant chiefs such as Hone Heke, Pamuka, Te Farirahi, Tamati Waka Nene and his brother Eruera Maihi Pachuone were accepting of the governor. Hone Heke said, "Governor, you should stay with us and be like a father. If you go away then the French or the rum sellers will take us Maori people over. How to you? Some of you tell Hobson to go, but that's not going to solve our difficulties. We have already sold so much land here in the north. We have no way of controlling the Europeans who have settled on it. I'm amazed to hear you telling him to go. Why didn't you tell the traders and grog sellers to go years ago? There are too many Europeans here now and there are children that will unite our races." Bishop Pompilier, who had been counseling the many Catholic Maori in the north concerning the treaty, urged them to be very wary of the treaty and not to sign anything. He left after the initial discussions and was not present when the chiefs signed afterward. The chiefs then moved to a river flat below Busby's house and lawn and continued deliberations late into the night, signing one of the signatories, Hone Heke, with his wife Hariata Tamati Waka Nene of Napuhi was a signatory, and he also was influential in convincing others to sign too. Hobson had planned for the signing to occur on the 7th of February. However, on the morning of the 6th of February, 45 chiefs were waiting ready to sign. Around noon, a ship carrying two officers from HMS Herald arrived and were surprised to hear they were waiting for the governor, so a boat was quickly dispatched back to let him know. Although the official painting of the signing shows Hobson wearing full naval regalia, he was in fact not expecting the chiefs that day and was wearing his dressing gown or in plain clothes, except his hat. The treaty signing began in the afternoon. Hobson headed the British signatories. Hone Heke was the first of the Maori chiefs who signed that day. As each chief signed, Hobson said, "He iwi tahi tatu," meaning, "We are one people." Two chiefs, Marupo and Ru, protested strongly against the treaty as the signing took place, but they eventually signed, and after Marupo shook the governor's hand, seized hold of his hat which was on the table and gestured to put it in to enhance its authority, 8 additional copies of the treaty were sent around the country to gather additional signatures, the Manukau Kawhia copy, the Waikato Manukau copy, the Tauranga copy, the Bay of Plenty copy, the Harold Bunbury copy, the Henry Williams copy, the Tauranga East Coast copy, and the printed copy. About 50 meetings were held from February to September 1840 to discuss and sign the copies, and a further 500 signatures were added to the treaty. A number of chiefs and some tribal groups refused to sign, including Potatau Te Werofero Waikato Iwi, Tuho, Te Arawa and Ngāti Tufaritoa and possibly Moka Kainga Mata. Some were not given the opportunity to sign. A number of non-signatory Waikato and Central North Island chiefs would later form a kind of confederacy with an elected monarch called the Kingatanga. The Kingatanga movement would later form a primary anti-government force in the New Zealand Wars. Nonetheless, on 21 May 1840, Lieutenant Governor Hobson proclaimed sovereignty over the whole country. The North Island by treaty and the South Island by discovery and New Zealand was constituted as a colony separate from New South Wales on 16 November 1840. Extant copies in 1841, treaty documents, housed in an iron box, narrowly escaped damage when the government offices at Official Bay in Auckland were destroyed by fire. They disappeared from sight until 1865, when a native department officer worked on them in Wellington at the request of Parliament and produced an erroneous list of signatories. The papers were fastened together and then deposited in a safe in the Colonial Secretary's office in 1877. The English language rough draft of the treaty was published along with photolithographic facsimiles, and the originals were returned to storage in 1911. Historian and bibliographer Dr. Thomas Hawken, searching for historical documents, found the treaty papers in poor condition, damaged at the edges by water and partly eaten by rodents. The papers were restored by the Dominion Museum in 1913 and kept in special boxes from then on. In February 1940, the treaty documents were taken to Waitangi for display in the Treaty House during the centenary celebrations. It was possibly the first time the treaty document had been on public display since it was signed after the outbreak of war with Japan. They were placed with other state documents in an outsize luggage trunk and deposited for secure custody with the public trustee at Palmerston North by the local MP, who did not tell staff what was in the case. However, as the case was too large to fit in the safe, the treaty document spent the war at the side of a back corridor in the public trust office. Manuscript copy of the Treaty of Waitangi in Māori in the hand of Henry Tacey Kemp in 1956, the Department of Internal Affairs placed the treaty documents in the care of the Alexander Turnbull Library and they were displayed in 1961. Further preservation steps were taken in 1966, with improvements to the display conditions from 1977 to 1980. The library extensively restored the documents before the treaty was deposited in the Reserve Bank in anticipation of a decision to exhibit the document in 1990. The sesquicentennial of the signing, full documentation and reproduction photography was carried out. Several years of planning culminated with the opening of the Constitution Room at the then National Archives by Mike Moore, Prime Minister of New Zealand. In November 1990, it was announced in 2012 that the 9 Treaty of Waitangi sheets would be relocated to the National Library of New Zealand in 2013. Meaning and interpretation. The treaty itself is short, consisting of a preamble and 3 articles. The preamble presents Queen Victoria being desirous to establish a settled form of civil government, and invites Maori chiefs to concur in the following articles. The first article of the English version grants the Queen of England sovereignty over New Zealand. The second article guarantees to the chiefs full, exclusive and undisturbed possession of their lands and estates, forests, fisheries and other properties. It also specifies that Maori will sell land only to the Crown. Crown preemption. The third article guarantees to all Maori the same rights as all other British subjects. In 2010, the Waitangi Tribunal began hearings into the Ngāpuhi's claim that sovereignty was not given up in their signing of the Treaty of Waitangi. The tribunal, in Te Paparahi o Te Reiki Inquiry Y1040, is considering the Maori and Crown understandings of He Whakaputanga o Te Rangatiratanga, the Declaration of Independence 1835 and Te Tiriti o Waitangi, the Treaty of Waitangi. The Te Paparahi o Te Reiki Stage 1 Inquiry Hearings phase was intended to reach conclusions as to the meaning and effect of the treaty for the Crown and Te Reiki Māori in 1840. The key conclusion of the Stage 1 report was that the treaty signatories did not cede sovereignty in February 1840, that is, they did not cede authority to make and enforce law over their people or their territories. The Rangatira did, however, agree to share power and authority with Britain. The consequences of the findings in the Stage 1 report are being considered in the Te Reiki Stage 2 inquiry, including considering the immediate aftermath of the Treaty of Waitangi, the Northern War 1844-46 and Crown preemption. Differences between English and Maori versions. The English and Maori versions differ. This has made it difficult to interpret the treaty and continues to undermine its effect. The most critical difference revolves around the interpretation of 3 Maori words: Kawanatanga governorship, which is ceded to the Queen in the first article, Rangatiratanga chief chieftainship, not mana leadership, which was stated in the Declaration of Independence just 5 years before the treaty was signed, which is retained by the chiefs in the second, and Teanga property or valued possessions, which the chiefs are guaranteed ownership and control of. Also in the second article, few Maori involved with the treaty negotiations had a good understanding of either sovereignty or governorship, as understood by 19th century Europeans, and lawyer Moana Jackson has stated that ceding mana or sovereignty in a treaty was legally and culturally and comprehensible in Maori terms. Furthermore, Kawanatanga is a loan translation from governorship and was not part of the Maori language. The term had been used by Henry Williams in his translation of the Declaration of Independence of New Zealand, which was signed by 35 Northern Maori chiefs at Waitangi on 28 October 1835. The Declaration of Independence of New Zealand had stated Ko te kingatanga, ko te mana I te wenua, to describe all sovereign power and authority in the land. There is considerable debate about what would have been a more appropriate term. Some scholars, notably Ruth Ross, argue that mana prestige, authority, would have more accurately conveyed the transfer of sovereignty. However, it has more recently been argued by others, including Judith Binney, that mana would not have been appropriate. This is because mana is not the same thing as sovereignty, and also because no one can give up their mana. The English language version recognizes Maori rights to properties, which seems to imply physical and perhaps intellectual property. The Maori version, on the other hand, mentions teanga, meaning treasures or precious things. In Maori usage, the term applies much more broadly than the English concept of legal property, and since the 1980s, courts have found that the term can encompass intangible things such as language and culture, even where physical property such as land is concerned. Differing cultural understandings as to what types of land are able to be privately owned have caused problems, as for example in the foreshore and seabed controversy of 2003-04, the pre-emption clause is generally not well translated, and many Maori apparently believe that they were simply giving the British Queen first offer on land, after which they could sell it to anyone. Doubt has been cast on whether Hobson himself actually understood the concept of pre-emption. Another, less important, difference is that Ingarani, meaning England alone, is used throughout in the Maori version, whereas the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland is used in the first paragraph of the English. Difficulties in cross-cultural communication. The entire issue is further complicated by the fact that, at the time, Maori society was an oral rather than literate one. Maori present at the signing of the treaty would have placed more value and reliance on what Hobson and the missionaries said, rather than the words of the actual treaty at the time of the signing. By over 600 chiefs, only 12 could sign their own name, and most of these had a very shaky, uncertain style indicating inexperience with writing. The rest put an X or drew part of their Moko. Maori beliefs and attitudes towards ownership and use of land were different from those prevailing in Britain and Europe. The chiefs would traditionally grant permission for the land to be used for a time for a particular purpose. A northern chief, Nopeira Panakarieo, also early on summarized his understanding of the treaty as Ko te atara u o te whenua I riro I a te kuini, Ko te tinana o te whenua I Waiho ki na Maori. The shadow of the land will go to the Queen, but the substance of the land will remain with us. Nopeira later reversed his earlier statement, feeling that the substance of the land had indeed gone to the Queen, only the shadow remained for the Maori effects. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. February 2011. Learn how and when to remove this template message. In November 1840, a royal charter was signed by Queen Victoria, establishing New Zealand as a crown colony separate from New South Wales from May 1841. The short-term effect of the treaty was to prevent the sale of Maori land to anyone other than the crown. This was intended to protect Maori from the kinds of shady land purchases which had alienated indigenous peoples in other parts of the world from their land with minimal compensation. Anticipating the treaty, the New Zealand Company made several hasty land deals and shipped settlers from Great Britain to New Zealand, hoping the British would be forced to accept its land claims as a fait accompli. In part, the treaty was an attempt to establish a system of property rights for land, with the Crown controlling and overseeing land sale to prevent abuse, and initially this worked well. Maori were eager to sell land, and settlers eager to buy. The Crown mediated the process to ensure that the true owners were properly identified. Difficult for tribally owned land and fairly compensated by the standards of the time. However, after a while Maori became disillusioned and less willing to sell, while the Crown came under increasing pressure from settlers wishing to buy. Consequently, government land agents were involved in a number of dubious land purchases. Agreements were negotiated with only one owner of tribally owned land, and in some cases land was purchased from the wrong people altogether. Eventually this led to the New Zealand Wars, which culminated in the confiscation of a large part of the Waikato and Taranaki in later years. This oversight role was vested in the Native Land Court under the Native Land Court Act of 1862, and later renamed the Maori Land Court. It was through this court that much Maori land was alienated, and the way in which it functioned is much criticized today. Over the longer term, the land purchase aspect of the treaty declined in importance, while the clauses of the treaty which deal with sovereignty and Maori rights took on greater importance. The treaty was never ratified by the United Kingdom and carried no legal force in New Zealand for over a century, finally receiving limited recognition in 1975 with the passage of the Treaty of Waitangi Act. The Colonial Office and early New Zealand governors were initially fairly supportive of the treaty, as it gave them authority over both New Zealand Company settlers and Maori, as the settlers were granted representative and responsible government with the New Zealand Constitution Act 1852. The treaty became less effective, although it was used to justify the idea that Waikato and Taranaki were rebels against the Crown in the Wars of the 1860s court cases later in the 19th century, especially Y. Parada v. the Bishop of Wellington 1877, established the principle that the treaty was a legal nullity, which could be ignored by the courts and the government. This argument was supported by the claim that New Zealand had become a colony when annexed by proclamation in January 1840, before the treaty was signed. Furthermore, Hobson only claimed to have taken possession of the North Island by treaty, the South Island he claimed by right of discovery, observing that Maori were so sparse there that it could be considered uninhabited. Despite this, Maori frequently used the treaty to argue for a range of demands, including greater independence and return of confiscated and unfairly purchased land. This was especially the case from the mid-19th century, when they lost numerical superiority and generally lost control of most of the country. The treaty returned to the public eye after the treaty house and grounds were purchased by the Governor-General, Viscount Bledisloe, in the early 1930s and donated to the nation. The dedication of the site as a national reserve in 1934 was probably the first major event held there since the 1840s. The profile of the treaty was further raised by the centenary of 1940. For most of the 20th century, textbooks, government publicity, and many historians touted the treaty as the moral foundation of colonization and argued that it set race relations in New Zealand above those of colonies in North America, Africa, and Australia. Its lack of legal significance in 1840 and subsequent breaches tended to be overlooked until the 1970s, when these issues were raised by Maori protest legal standing. The treaty itself has never been ratified or enacted as statute law in New Zealand, although it does appear in authoritative collections of treaties, and is sometimes referred to in specific pieces of legislation. There are two major points of legal debate concerning the treaty: whether or not the treaty was the means by which the British Crown gained sovereignty over New Zealand, whether or not the treaty is binding on the Crown sovereignty. Although the treaty was considered to be Maori consenting to British sovereignty over the whole country, the actual proclamation of sovereignty was made by Hobson on 21 May 1840, the North Island by treaty and the South by discovery. Hobson was unaware his agents were collecting signatures for the treaty in the South Island at this stage. This was in response to New Zealand Company attempts to establish a separate colony in Wellington. The proclamation was published 4 months after the signing of the treaty, in the New Zealand Advertiser and Bay of Islands Gazette issue of 19 June 1840. The proclamation asserts on the grounds of discovery, the sovereign rights of Her Majesty over the southern islands of New Zealand, commonly called the Middle Island, South Island and Stewart's Island, Stewart Island, Rikura, and the island, commonly called the Northern Island, having been ceded in sovereignty to Her Majesty. In the 1877 Y. Parada v. Bishop of Wellington judgment, Prendergast argued that the treaty was a simple nullity in terms of transferring sovereignty from Maori to the United Kingdom. This remained the legal orthodoxy until at least the 1970s. Since then, legal commentators have argued that whatever the state of Maori government in 1840, the British had acknowledged Maori sovereignty with the Declaration of the Independence of New Zealand in 1835. Therefore, if both parties had agreed on the treaty, it was valid in a pragmatic, if not necessarily a legal sense. There has been some popular acceptance of the idea that the treaty transferred sovereignty since the early 20th century. Popular histories of New Zealand and the treaty often claimed that the treaty was an example of British benevolence and therefore an honourable contract. Waitangi Tribunal's Te Paparahi o Te Reiki Inquiry. The Waitangi Tribunal, in Te Paparahi o Te Reiki Inquiry Y1040, is in the process of considering the Maori and Crown understandings of Hifukaputanga o Te Rangatiratanga, the Declaration of Independence 1835 and Tatreaty o Waitangi, the Treaty of Waitangi 1840. This aspect of the inquiry raises issues as to the nature of sovereignty and whether the Maori signatories to the Treaty of Waitangi intended to transfer sovereignty. The first stage of the report was released in November 2014, and found that Maori chiefs never agreed to give up their sovereignty when they signed the Treaty of Waitangi in 1840. Although the Crown intended to negotiate the transfer of sovereignty through the treaty, the chiefs' understanding of the agreement was they were only ceding the power for the Crown to control Pākehā and protect Maori. Tribunal manager Julie Tangaori said at the report's release to the Ngāpuhi claimants, "Your tūpuna did not give away their mana at Waitangi, at Waimate, at Mangungu. They did not cede their sovereignty. This is the truth you have been waiting a long time to hear." However, the tribunal's finding does not establish that the Crown does not have sovereignty today. Treaty Settlements Minister Chris Finlayson emphasized that the tribunal doesn't reach any conclusion regarding the sovereignty the Crown exercises in New Zealand, nor does it address The other events considered part of the Crown's acquisition of sovereignty are how the treaty relationship should operate today, binding on the Crown, while the above issue is mostly academic. Since the Crown has de facto sovereignty in New Zealand, the question of whether the Crown is bound by the treaty has been hotly contested since 1840. This has been a point of a number of court cases. R. v. Simmons, 1847. The treaty was found to be binding on the Crown. Y. Parada v. Bishop of Wellington, 1877. Judge James Prendergast called the treaty a simple nullity and claimed that it was neither a valid treaty nor binding on the Crown. Although the treaty's status was not a major part of the case, Prendergast's judgment on the treaty's validity was considered definitive for many decades. Te Heuheu Takino v. Aotea District Maori Land Board, 1938. The treaty was seen as valid in terms of the transfer of sovereignty, but the judge ruled that as it was not part of New Zealand law, it was not binding on the Crown. New Zealand Maori Council v. Attorney General, 1987. Also known as the SOE State-Owned Enterprises case, this defined the principles of the treaty. The State-Owned Enterprises Act stated that nothing in the Act permitted the government to act inconsistently with the principles of the treaty, and the proposed sale of government assets was found to be in breach. Of this proviso, this case established the principle that if the treaty is mentioned in strong terms in a piece of legislation, it takes precedence over other parts of that legislation should they come into conflict. New Zealand Maori Council v. Attorney General, 1990. This case concerned FM radio frequencies and found that the treaty could be relevant even concerning legislation which did not mention it. Since the late 1980s, the treaty has become much more legally important. However, because of uncertainties about its meaning and translation, it still does not have a firm place in New Zealand law or jurisprudence. Another issue is whether the Crown in Right of New Zealand is bound. The separate New Zealand Crown was created when New Zealand adopted the Statute of Westminster in 1947, which granted legislative independence to New Zealand and created the Crown in Right of New Zealand. Martin Finlay rejected this contention. Legislation. The English version of the treaty appeared as a schedule to the Waitangi Day Act 1960, but this did not technically make it a part of statute law. The Treaty of Waitangi Act 1975 established the Waitangi Tribunal, but this initially had very limited powers to make findings of facts and recommendations only. The Act was amended in 1985 to enable it to investigate treaty breaches back to 1840, and also to increase the tribunal membership. The membership was further increased in another amendment in 1988. Although the treaty has never been incorporated into New Zealand municipal law, its provisions were first incorporated into legislation as early as the Land Claims Ordinance 1841 and the Native Rights Act 1865. Later, the treaty was incorporated into New Zealand law in the State-Owned Enterprises Act 1986. Section 9 said that nothing in the Act permitted the Crown to act in a manner that is inconsistent with the principles of the Treaty of Waitangi. This allowed the courts to consider the Crown's actions in terms of compliance with the treaty. Contemporary legislation has followed suit, giving the treaty an increased legal importance. The Fourth Labour Government's Bill of Rights White Paper proposed that the treaty be entrenched in the New Zealand Bill of Rights Act 1990. However, this proposal was never carried through to the legislation, with the attitude of many Maori towards it suspicious, uneasy, doubtful, or undecided. Many Maori were concerned that the proposal would relegate the treaty to a lesser position and enable the electorate, who under the original Bill of Rights would be able to repeal certain sections by referendum, to remove the treaty from the Bill of Rights altogether. Jeffrey Palmer has commented in 2013 that, "We were obliged, due to Maori opposition, to drop the treaty from the Bill of Rights. That was a great pity, and it is a step that I advocate be taken still in the context of having a superior law Bill of Rights." In response to a backlash against the treaty, politician Winston Peters, the 13th Deputy Prime Minister of New Zealand and founder of the New Zealand First Party, and others have campaigned to remove vague references to the treaty from New Zealand law. However, the New Zealand Maori Council case of 1990 indicated that even if references to the treaty were removed from legislation, the treaty may still be legally relevant. Principles of the Treaty. Main Article, Principles of the Treaty of Waitangi. The principles of the treaty are often mentioned in contemporary New Zealand politics. They originate from the famous case brought in the High Court by the New Zealand Maori Council in 1987, New Zealand Maori Council v. Attorney General. There was great concern at that time about the ongoing restructuring of the New Zealand economy by the then Fourth Labour Government, specifically the transfer of assets from former government departments to state-owned enterprises, because the state-owned enterprises were essentially private firms owned by the government. There was an argument that they would prevent assets which had been given by Maori for use by the state from being returned to Maori by the Waitangi Tribunal and Through treaty settlements, the Maori Council sought enforcement of Section 9 of the State-Owned Enterprises Act 1986, which reads, "Nothing in this Act shall permit the Crown to act in a manner that is inconsistent with the principles of the Treaty of Waitangi." The Court of Appeal, in a judgment of its then-president Sir Robin Cook, decided upon the following treaty principles: the acquisition of sovereignty in exchange for the protection of Rangatiratanga. The treaty established a partnership, and imposes on the partners the duty to act reasonably and in good faith, the freedom of the Crown to govern, the Crown's duty of active protection, the duty of the Crown to remedy past breaches, Maori to retain Rangatiratanga over their resources and Tayanga, and to have all the privileges of citizenship, duty to consult Fourth Labour Government's principles. In 1989, the Fourth Labour Government responded by adopting the following principles for Crown action on the Treaty of Waitangi: principle of government, the Kawanatanga principle. Principle of self-management, the Rangatiratanga principle. Principle of equality. Principle of reasonable cooperation. Principle of redress. Principles. Deletion Bill. The principles of the Treaty of Waitangi Deletion Bill was introduced in the New Zealand Parliament in 2005 as a private member's bill by New Zealand First MP Doug Woolerton. This bill eliminates all references to the expressions "the principles of the treaty," "the principles of the Treaty of Waitangi," and "the Treaty of Waitangi and its principles" from all New Zealand statutes, including all preambles, interpretations, schedules, regulations and other provisos included in or arising from each and every such statute. The bill failed to pass its second reading in November 2007. Claims for redress. Main article, Treaty of Waitangi claims and settlements. Reverse of a 1991 dollar coin commemorating the sesquicentenary of the Treaty of Waitangi using a different design. A much rarer New Zealand Crown commemorative coin was also minted in 1935. During the late 1960s and 1970s, the Treaty of Waitangi became the focus of a strong Maori protest movement, which rallied around calls for the government to honor the treaty and to redress treaty grievances. Maori expressed their frustration about continuing violations of the treaty and subsequent legislation by government officials, as well as inequitable legislation and unsympathetic decisions by the Maori Land Court alienating Maori land from its Maori owners. During the early 1990s, the government began to negotiate settlements of historical pre-1992 claims. As of September 2008, there have been 23 such settlements of various sizes, totaling approximately $700. Technologies developed since colonization. Examples include the ownership of the radio spectrum and the protection of the Maori language. The 2008 New Zealand election study found that among the 2,700 voting-age New Zealanders surveyed, 374% wanted the treaty removed from New Zealand law, 197% were neutral, and 368% wanted the treaty kept in law. Additionally, 397% agreed Maori deserved compensation, 157% were neutral, and 412% disagreed. Commemoration. Main article, Waitangi Day. A protest on Waitangi Day 2006, however irrelevant in law, the treaty returned to the public eye after the Treaty House and Grounds were purchased by Governor-General Viscount Bledisloe in the early 1930s and donated to New Zealand. The anniversary of the signing of the treaty is a New Zealand public holiday, Waitangi Day. On 6 February, the first Waitangi Day was not until 1947, although there were some commemorations before that, and the day was not made a public holiday until 1974. The commemoration has often been the focus of protest by Maori and frequently attracts controversy. The anniversary is officially commemorated at the Treaty House at Waitangi, where it was first signed. See also Constitution of New Zealand. Te Ture Whenua. Maori Act 1993, Maori Land Act 1993. References. Carrot. Patricia Burns, 1989. Fatal Success, A History of the New Zealand Company. Heinemann Reid P. Carrot. Treaty of Waitangi, Questions and Answers. PDF Network. Waitangi 2012 p. pp. 114-116. Paul Moon, 5 October 2010. Paul Moon, Agreement Long Ago Left in Tatters. The New Zealand Herald. Carrot. Wise's New Zealand Guide, 7th edition, 1979 p. 499. Carrot. King, Marie, 1949. A Port in the North, A Short History of Russell. P. 38. Carrot. Paul Moon, Hope for Watershed in New Treaty Era. The New Zealand Herald. 13 January 2010. Retrieved 15 January 2010. Carrot. ABCDE. Orange, Claudia, 2004. An Illustrated History of the Treaty of Waitangi. Wellington, Bridget Williams Books. ISBN PDF. Waitangi Tribunal 2014. Retrieved 25 July 2015. Carat Radio Spectrum Management and Development Final Report Y776 Waitangi Tribunal 1999 retrieved 1 September 2011. New Zealand, 1830-1847 Auckland, Auckland University Press.